I just wanted to thank everyone for joining in this afternoon. I'm Michelle Morgan. I'm the Digital Accessibility Specialist here at Yale, and I work on making websites and course materials more accessible for students with disabilities. And that is involved both with ITS and then also with the Center for Teaching and Learning with the Poor View Center. And Claire is my co-host. I'll let her introduce herself.
Hi, I'm Claire. I work with the Educational Technology team at the Poor View Center, and I have the pleasure of working with Michelle. So I'll be speaking mostly on the Canvas side of setting things up.
Great. Thanks, Claire. And so basically what we're going to cover today, Claire is going to walk us through the ways to add extra time for assignments and for quizzes in Canvas, and just show you some quick and easy ways to do that if you have students who have time and a half. Or extra time on their accommodations letters that you may have received at some point. She's also going to show us how to set Canvas settings to the proper time zone in case you are doing timed exams or releasing exams for students who are in other time zones. She'll talk a little bit about how to change the settings in Canvas and why that's important. I'm going to do the second half of this session. I'll talk about uploading OCR'd PDFs and what that even means to quizzes and assignments so that students who use screen readers are able to access any assignments or exams that you upload into Canvas. I'll talk just a little bit of how to make those accessible from the get-go. We'll talk a little bit about color contrast, magnification, captioning, some very basic accessibility things that you can do in Canvas for your students with disabilities, but I'm not going to get into the weeds with how to do those. We're just going to give a really broad overview of what they are, and then you can get in touch with me outside of this session if you have more questions about that. I also wanted to point out that we have some guest participants here who are in the session, and they're here to answer questions if you have questions in the chat. Especially, I want to point out that Susan Olson is here, and she is from the Student Accessibility Services Office. So if you have any questions specifically about accommodations that I'm not sure Claire or I should answer, she's here, and she can jump in at any point as well to answer those questions, or you could talk to her in the chat. Before we get started, does anybody have any questions? Great. Claire, you want to take it away, I guess?
I'll take it away. Let me share my screen. All right, so the first thing that I want to cover is the time zone stuff, and that's because it's kind of at your individual settings. So you want to make sure that your settings are correct, and as well as your student settings are matching the time zone that you are currently in, or that they are currently in. So to change your time zone in your account settings, you go to this profile picture here. If you upload a profile picture, it should not be your picture, but since I didn't, it's kind of, you know, the generic one. So click on that and it'll bring up this panel, and go to your settings. And from your settings, you can see here, time zone. It's listed for me as Eastern time because I've set it. It may be something different if you're in a different time zone. I believe by default for all Yale users, there's default Eastern. But to change it, if it's incorrect, go to this Edit Settings. And then it'll turn these two into drop-down. So I can click on the drop-down and change it to whatever I need it to change it to. So I'm going to keep it at Eastern. But make sure that if you do change it, you click on Update Settings. And then it should save for you. And it'll go back to not being a drop-down. So that's just a really easy way to set your time zone. And time zone does matter just because your due dates, your availability dates are going to be based off of that. And yeah, that's how you set time zone. Really easy, really quick. So that's why I want to get in before we jump into the course itself. I'm going to go back to my dashboard and we'll get into setting assignments and quizzes for accommodations. But before I do that, one more thing before I do that, I wanna talk about sandboxes. In order to test anything out, if you're concerned about, you know, making a mistake in your actual courses, or you wanna just kind of play around with it before you set it up in your actual course, you should always, you can always request a sandbox request, and I can link that, or someone can link that in the chat. And the sandbox is kind of just your own personal playground. You can invite other like TAs, guest instructors, If you're working with anyone on that, and that was a great place for you to kind of test out the quizzes, test out assignments to make sure that they are working the way you want them to work before you create anything. So you see here, I have a sandbox here. It's just kind of a sample generic sandbox, and that's where I'll show you how to get things done. So the first thing I want to talk about is assignments. And this is something that can be done on assignments, discussions, and quizzes, is if you have an individual who has time requirements that have, maybe they need an extended due date, or they need assignments open earlier. You can set that by going to the due dates and the assigned, the availability dates, and that's going to be available on assignments, discussion boards, and quizzes. And that's just going to be in this setting. So when I go to assignments and I go to plus assignments here to create a new assignment, it's the same way place you go when you're creating an assignment. So I'm just going to name the sample assignment one. You can set your settings how you need to, but the important thing is once you have it set, and you're setting it up for an individual. Right now it says assigned to everyone, and maybe the due date for this is going to be 3 weeks from now on April 23rd, and that's when it's due for everyone. But if you have an individual that needs an earlier due date, you can click this plus add, and it's important to do it this way instead of creating a separate assignment for them, just because this will make the assignment in the gradebook the same for everyone. If you were to duplicate, it would create a second column for everyone. So doing this plus add makes sure that the same assignment goes out to everyone and it keeps in the same column in the gradebook. But now this assigned to, you can see here, this dropdown that popped up, I can select individual students. So I'm gonna select this tester account that I have. And you can see now it's changed up top here from everyone to everyone else. So everyone else is still due on April 23rd. And I can extend this individual's due date to maybe the week later, to April 30th. So that's how you can extend the due date to, if you have an availability date. So availability date is different from due date. Due date is when the assignment is due, but they can always submit it late. If you want them to have access to it, you want to stop access to it on the date that it's due, you can set it that way, saying that they only have access to it until the due date. And maybe you want this to open automatically at a certain time. So maybe this is not going to be assigned to them until a week from now. But if you want to open it earlier for an individual, maybe they have an accommodation that allows them to access an assignment earlier. You, from the availability date for the individual student, you can set the availability to maybe I want to open today instead. And then same thing with this, if I wanted the availability to go until the 30th instead of to the 23rd. So this assigned portion is going to be here for, again, assignments, discussion boards, and quizzes. So when you're setting up quizzes, you'll see this too. It's going to be the same way when you're doing assignments and quizzes to open up early or to end later. So I'm going to go ahead and save this. And students won't be able to see it until I publish it. But now when I click on publish, because I have this availability date, they won't see, they'll be able to see that the assignment exists, but they won't be able to access it until the date listed. And you can see here that the different due dates and the different availability dates are going to be listed, giving a summary of everyone else has this normal time per frame, and the individual has this extended time frame. So that's how you do that for assignments. Quizzes may have different accommodations in terms of timing, and maybe they have time and a half on a quiz, or they have perhaps extra attempts. You can easily do that by going to quizzes and setting up quizzes that way, but I'm going to create a sample quiz from scratch so you can see how that looks like. I'm going to go to plus quiz button up top in the quizzes page. And again, you can set up your quiz as normal, so sample quiz. And going through the, I'm going to call it sample quiz one, and going through, I can enter the description of the quiz here. This is going to be something that they see before the quiz starts. So make sure that's nothing that is pertinent to quiz information that they shouldn't have prior to quiz beginning. I'm going to say that this, for example, this time limit to the test is 60 minutes. And that is what the standard amount of time is that everyone has. And I'll show you later how to give them time and a half for individuals. But scrolling down here, you can see again, this assign to exists just like it did in the assignments. And right now it sets everyone. And I'm gonna set it to the same settings that I had before where it's due on the 23rd and I have it opening next week until the 23rd. But I have this individual who has accommodations, and this is one of two ways that you can open it up early for them. So say that's the due date for them is going to be the 30th, so I'm kind of giving them extra time on the due date. And I can open up earlier by having the availability date set to a different, an earlier time, and that opens up early for them. So that's, like I said, one of two ways to do it. This is how you would do it from the get-go when you're setting it up. But if you find out later afterwards, or you can always come back to do it this way, or you can, I'm going to show you a second way to do that. But I'm going to go ahead and save this now that I have this, the settings for this, the quiz, and I'm going to click save. So when I have it saved, I can see that again, it's listed out, everyone else has it on these dates, and the individual has the accommodations, but I'm not seeing any of the any other options for the quiz, and that's because that's not published. In order to see the quiz options, you have to have it published. And that's why it's important to have these availability dates set, is because if you have it published, but you don't have these availability dates, it's gonna be available to everyone as soon as it's published. So make sure you have those availability dates if you don't want students to see, to access the exam before it's ready. So I'm gonna go ahead and click publish. And now that it's published, the page has refreshed. And you can see here on the right-hand side, some quiz options have appeared for me. And if I click on this moderate this quiz, that's gonna allow me to do a couple things. It's going to allow me to extend students' time to time and a half, or to however, you know, long time that they have. Or I can also, it gives me the second option to unlock a quiz, and it's also going to give me the option to give someone extra attempts. So I'm going to go ahead and click on moderate this quiz. And now you see I have all these students, each individual student listed out. I only have 5 test students in my sample course, so you're probably going to see more. And everyone has 1 attempt, and this column shows them how many attempts that have been completed for each individual. Because it's a new quiz, you know, there's no attempts, and it shows how much time they took on that attempt. To give students, individual students, you know, extra time, extra attempts, what have you, you'll come to this right-hand side, click on the pencil icon, and it's the change user extensions. So if I click on that, a box is going to appear for me, and it's going to give me a couple options. It's going to say extra attempts, extra time on attempts, and manually unlock quiz. So it's talking about extra attempts. You see here, it's a little grayed out and it's a smaller text, but it says everyone already gets one. That means that everyone already gets one attempt, so it's not gonna be calculated into what you put here. So if an individual gets 2 attempts instead of 1, you would just need to say they get 1 extra attempt because everyone already gets one. That's true about the extra time on every attempt as well. So you, here it says in the grayed out, everyone already gets 60 minutes. That's because when I set up the time limit in the quiz settings, I had listed 60 minutes. So if they get time and a half and they're getting 90 minutes instead of 60, since it's already calculating that everyone gets 60, I would put instead here 30 instead of 90. And then lastly, I want to talk about, this is the second way you can unlock a quiz early for a student. So if a student is, you know, they need to take the quiz right now instead of a week from now when it is ready to be open. If you hadn't set that up before, you can actually just manually unlock the quiz by clicking on this checkbox and clicking save. By doing it this way, you're saying you want to open right now, the moment you click save, to the individual that you're changing. The doing it the way before in the when you're setting up the quiz, that's going to do it automatically at the time that you set, at the date and time. So that's the difference between those two. So I'm gonna go ahead and make sure I click save to save those changes I made. And now you can see here, they have two attempts now instead of one like everyone else. And underneath their name, it says they get an extra 30 minutes on each attempt. And then coming to the right here, you can see there's this lock icon that's unlocked, indicates to me that the quiz is unlocked early for them. And that concludes kind of what I wanted to talk about the settings, really basic settings for the most common kind of accommodation request within Canvas for your assignments and for your quizzes. If you have any questions, I can take them now.
Yeah, there is a question actually, yeah. Claire. In the chat, it says, if you don't set a time limit, will an attempt time out automatically after a certain point?
I don't believe it times out. It does. There is a limit to, I believe, to like logging in. So like if you're cast into Canvas and you start a quiz and then you kind of leave it for however long it takes for the CAS to time out, it may quit out on you. But as far as if you don't have a time limit, it's not gonna, if you're taking, you know, several hours instead of, you know, half an hour, it's not gonna, shouldn't time out on you. And I will say that if you do not set up the time limit in the quiz setting, this extra time on every attempt, that option's not going to show up unless you have the time limit set already. We learned that the other day while we were kind of testing through this. But all right, if we don't have any other questions about the settings in Canvas, I'm going to turn it over to Michelle.
So what I'm going to cover now are just some basics around accessibility. So if you were here just to learn how to set up extra time, we're done with that portion, but I do want to cover some other key considerations for accessibility for students with disabilities inside of Canvas itself. So I'm looking here, what we're looking at is a course that I have developed that's in Canvas around developing an accessible course, and I'm going to use this as my example, or kind of like Claire used her sandbox. One of the things that I think is really important is just understanding what accessibility means. So we use this word a lot. Sometimes people think about it in terms of physical accommodations, making something accessible, as in, can this person get from point A to point B physically? But as far as Canvas is concerned, we're really talking about digital accessibility. And Canvas itself is a really accessible tool, which means that someone who is, say, using nothing but a keyboard to jump around, you'll see as I jump through here that there are boxes that appear around different things that you can click on. That means that it's accessible to a keyboard, so someone who's not using a mouse to click on things can jump around and select different options. Usually what we find is that software might be accessible, and that's great, but it's the stuff we add to it that's not accessible, and that's truly the case with Canvas as well. We have all these different options in Canvas. When you create an assignment or you create a quiz and you type out your questions and they show up on the screen for the student is able to access those questions. They can see them They can navigate through the screen with their keyboard without too many issues or any issues. But it's the content that we add to Canvas that can really present barriers for our students. One of the things that is really a fundamental for accessibility around course materials is making sure that any kind of documents that we share with our students are accessible. And I can do like a whole week's worth of courses on this. For the purposes of today, I just want to talk about what you should do if you're uploading a document that you've created that's going to be a test or an assignment of some sort. So this would be a case where you might type up a test or some kind of assignment in your using Word, and then you share it under the quiz or the assignment tool. And so it's easier to describe this through slides than it is through just me rambling on. So what happens when a PDF isn't accessible is that it just really basically is a picture of that PDF. And so a student who's using a screen reader, they may be able to listen or navigate through Canvas, through an assignment, or through a quiz that's built inside Canvas. But if you upload a PDF that has not gone through this process, then the student won't be able to use it with their screen reader. And to make a document baseline accessible, it has to go through a process called optical character recognition. Basically, that's exactly what it sounds like. It's just it recognizes each of the characters on that page, and it converts a single image document into a document that you can select the text and the screen reader assistive tech can read it out loud. People often will ask why can't I copy and paste from this PDF? But sometimes I can. If it's a PDF that's gone through OCR, you can copy and paste the text. Other times, if you select and it's just a box, that means it hasn't gone through that process and a screen reader cannot tell what's on that page. So this is just a real quick, easy way to determine if something's been OCR'd or not. Now, that might be great if you're uploading readings to the file section or whatever and you want to know if they're OCR'd, but if you are building a quiz or you're building an assignment of some kind and you upload the PDF to that section in Canvas, there are ways that you can take that Word document that you made and save it so that it's accessible once it's been uploaded. Basically, what I have here are two different views. I have both the Mac view and the Windows view. On a Mac, what I did for years is I would just go save and then I would print as PDF, but that will render an inaccessible PDF. I see something in the chat here, so. Oh, okay, yes. So if you're actually creating it in the question in the chat asked if quizzes created in Canvas are OCR compatible. Yes, anything that you create inside Canvas, the questions themselves, is fine. This is strictly for when you want to upload a document to an assignment or to a quiz, and you want to make sure that that PDF is itself accessible as well. So anything created within Canvas is good to go. If you create it outside, like you created a Word document and you've uploaded it to assignments or quizzes, then this is what you just need to do to make sure that it's accessible. You don't want to print as, you want to save as. So if you use a Mac, you may have noticed there is actually a thing, and I know it's tiny here, but it says best for electronic distribution and accessibility. If you go ahead and save it that way, then it will be OCR'd for the student who uses the screen reader. The same thing is true for Windows. Save as either, you can either save as or save as Adobe PDF, and that will make sure that a document that has been uploaded to Canvas can be read by a screen reader. The print PDF is what just takes a picture of it and makes it so it's not accessible. So having explained just a tiny bit there what the difference between an accessible and inaccessible PDF are, you may have noticed in Canvas, I'm going to use the file section just as an example. This is Ally, this little tool we have here where there are dials near everything. This will tell you whether or not your PDF is accessible or your PowerPoint. You'll notice on this one, if you click on those dials, everybody has them in their Canvas, that it'll say this PDF is scanned. It gets a 0%. That's because I cannot select the text. I'm sitting here with my cursor. I'm trying to actually select the text. I cannot select it. a screen reader would not be able to read this document. I have a variety of documents in here that I've made various levels of accessibility. This one is 100%. You'll notice I can select the text. A student who accesses this in Canvas will also be able to use their screen reader to read this document. And then just the third one, very briefly, I want to show you. Sometimes you'll see one where it's very low. It says it's untagged. This document can be selected and read by a screen reader. There are just other things that haven't been done to it that would make it a much more accessible student-friendly document. But it has been OCR'd, and a student will be able to listen to the words on this page. So again, that's I'm kind of like going straight to higher level questions around accessibility here, but I just wanted to make the point that if you're going to upload a PDF to your Canvas course and expect that a student in a quiz situation or an exam situation especially is going to be able to read it, it should be OCR'd. The other sort of major considerations, I think, for quizzes and assignments, anything time-based especially, just because students have fewer opportunities to get help in the moment. In this course here, I have some basic guidelines around making a Canvas course accessible. One of those is color. I'm not gonna belabor this point, but just be aware that if you're building any kind of graphs or charts or things that students may need to look at in order to answer the question correctly, that you don't rely on color only to convey any kind of, you know, key information. One, that's because so many students are colorblind, and so if something key is in red and a student can't detect red, then it would be very hard for them to understand that that's key to the question itself. Being aware of just the sort of general bad contrast that we can see sometimes, that's very hard for students with low vision or other visual disabilities to be able to discern. And then also, here's just another example, I guess, of, you could say, of how to not just use color to convey information. If you're using charts and graphs, if you add gradient or texture to your examples, then it allows someone who can't see color, who has a hard time discerning color, to be able to tell that there are differences between things. So we can talk, again, I could talk at length about color and color contrast and how to detect color contrast. Black and white is generally great. But if you're going to use color, just be cognizant of what you're doing and how you're using it. I've also seen a few questions. There's not really a good example of this, but one question that comes up, has come up a couple of times this semester around Canvas, is whether or not students who need magnification can see what they need to see. Canvas is very good at being dynamic and moderating like what you see on the screen. So you may have had students in the past who use magnification to see, and they can zoom in and out as they need in Canvas itself. So that generally is not an issue. If you have questions about that, Susan is in the chat too, and I'm sure she could answer a few more questions about that. And then lastly, if you're using any kind of video, if you're quizzing or posting video clips or doing any kind of testing where there's video, you really should make sure that those are captioned. You can do automatic captions if there aren't students in your course who have that accommodation. That's fine. If you have students with that accommodation, you know about it at this point and can work with the Student Accessibility Services to have those things captioned. But there are ways to get captions in Canvas on any kind of video that you post in Media Library. And I'm happy to show you how to do that, but if you're considering using video, it would be great to have those things captioned as well, especially in this situation, I think, where students may be quizzing or doing things online in places where there's a lot of sound or they've got a lot going on and they're using their headphones or they need it to be quiet, then it's a lot easier for them to do their work if there are captions on that media. So that is the last consideration. So OCRing PDFs. Making sure that the color contrast is decent on anything that you upload, making sure that things are captioned if they are video-based are really the big ones as far as accommodations go, I think, right now in Canvas. And I think that's it.
And if you have any questions that you think of after the fact or need to reach out to us for any reason at all, you can always contact us at askporviewcenter@yale.edu. And you can always visit, we have really great resources for academic continuity at academiccontinuity.yale.edu.
Yeah, I guess that's it.
That's a wrap. Okay.
Thanks, everyone.